I would like to call, Professor Charru Malhotra.
Namaskar, all of you. Good evening to all the brave ones who've still managed to stay back after such a long session. So I just need your full attention for just 5 or 7 minutes. My first thanks to the sponsors and to the invitees for giving us a chance to interact with you and to check whether, to do a reality check if we are on the right path or not. My second thanks is overdue to the moderator and the wonderful chairman we have, Professor Chandan, who's not just been introducing us, but is also making sure our PPTs run. So thanks a lot, sir. Thanks a lot. Okay, so since the job was to introduce ourselves, I just hurriedly put together the background I come from. We were talking constantly about reskilling, upskilling. Long and short of it is to stay updated. That's what it is. Come from, if you come from technical background, you've got to gel it with humanities and to the grassroots. If you come from grassroots, you better update your domain expertise so that you're not outdated. That's all about being competitive and up to mark. So my profile is something like that. I did my master's of computers from an engineering college, Thapar Engineering College, almost the gold medalist. Then did my PhD from IIT Delhi, work in an institute where I get to train all the senior government officers, which exposed me to the real India. When I'm training IAS, IPS and related civil service officers and visit them and see what they're doing as SDMs and DGs, I get to see real India, and that's how probably the amalgamation helped me to evolve further. Did my PhD by visiting 600 villages of the country to understand whether technology will ever work in Indian context or not. My learnings is what gets accumulated in this presentation. And while doing all this, the laurels were several. I'm very humble to say all the credit goes to people who supported me, the safety net. The recent one was something which I've been trying to put forth to the entire world, and which I saw some remnants in this workshop also, where we talked about soft skills being taught, ethics being taught, values being taught, which are far more important than the technical background. And that got me a best paper award from International Telecommunication Union, where I'm trying to force emotional quotient and spiritual quotient in technical expertise. Now, this is the reality. It's a quote which I've made myself, where IT is IT, information technology as well as it. So it's going to change completely the way we are. Like Professor Chandan said, working with robots would probably be a different skill set. Now, please, let's come to the reality, which I just picked up last night. 12 a.m., I read this news item which said flying cars are really a reality. Okay, so we've been reading about them, but if this is the reality, I take you to another part of the spectrum, which is a sad news, which was the crash of Ethiopian Airlines, where everybody was lost. And if you would read the clip, you would find the crash did not happen because of any other reason except that the pilots were not able to navigate the new artificial intelligence system which was put in there. So designing and manufacturing is going to be useless, redundant, not safe in case skills are not updated. So we have a dichotomy here. We have at one end all the emerging technologies, and on the other hand, we have people who are probably not equipped or not willing to learn or are not getting enough opportunities. So this is how I intend to go. Industrial Revolution 4.0 has infested all. When I say infested, because I come from capacity building and HR perspective, so I know that the technical component, the capacity building component, the skill component is still lacking in all kinds of stakeholders. And as I said, the other end of the spectrum is this actually coming to us from all sides. I don't need to read out each and every news item. I just picked up some news items which I had read, and I realized India can't be far away. So if this is the reality, when everything is interconnected, instrumented, and is intelligent, that is sensor. When you say intelligent, you should just read in your mind sensors and internet connectivity. So when everything is getting connected to this extent, we're going to have a lot of issues, and all these issues can just be stated as the first one. The whole system is going to be very unpredictable. You don't know from where the glitch would come. You don't know from, as Professor also said, Chandan, Professor Chandan, that you don't know where you get going to get hacked. Because you would have technical layers, you would have physical layers, you would have tools layer, you would have human layers, and then all of them are getting wired up. So this complicated ecosystem is the first glitch we anticipate in Industrial Revolution 4.0. Is that all? No. The more systems talk to each other, the more systems get connected to each other, there's a tornado, there's an avalanche, there is a landslide of data. Because you would have heterogeneous data flowing in from pipelines which can be just amalgamating itself to another shape where you can't even track. So because all these machines and software and algorithms are going to be data guzzlers, they are going to finally guzzle our jobs also. They know more than us. They know more than us to replace us for predictive decision making, for strategic decision making, and for routine mundane chores like front-end soldiers or restaurant waiters. So with this kind of scenario, I was trying to put it again and check whether what we are reading is true. And I'm sure a lot of you would have read this news item that we would very soon be replacing human beings in a hierarchy of evolution for our jobs. Now, even if you take it with a pinch of salt, why even a pinch of salt? A sack of salt we need to be wary of. Why we need to be wary of? Because any job loss, India at least cannot afford, where we have human power more intense than technology power. And now I come to the last part of this, this challenge paraphernalia. Please see this slide with all the passion, because I've designed it with all the passion. I'm sure this particular mobile reminds you of your own phones. May I help you? Maybe it's a Siri, or maybe it's Google, maybe it's Cortana, maybe it's Samsung Voice. Now, please look at what it's trying to say. Whenever you would, and this is out of research and not a whimsical, slide. Whenever somebody would ask them about these ailments like heart attacks or suicide rates, you'll get perfectly good answers. But when you ask them about this, your Siri would say, sorry, I don't know. Physical abuse, sexual abuse is totally alien to our conversational user interfaces. Why is it so? Despite the fact that physical abuse and sexual abuse is faced by almost 20% of the women, which is translating for physical abuse to one woman out of three women. And still your conversational user interface is not able to relate to it. Okay, I bring you to another story. This is one of the HealthFi, systems I'm trying to show. And I've specifically named it because this is where the research was all about. It has a slogan, it has a tagline, it says, I track everything which is important for your human body. Okay, then you must be knowing about what I go through every month. No, it doesn't. Why is it so? Because somewhere behind these machines, these industrial revolution technologies, all three sets, artificial intelligence, your blockchain digital platforms, and your augmented realities and virtual reality, there was a brain which was not gender sensitive. They were designing as, look at this dice. Is this gender friendly to the first women speaker today we had? Look at the size. Maybe somebody designed it thinking the women would never use it. I'm not saying it's not women-centric. Maybe I would say it's not size-centric. So design is a big issue. And when I tried putting it in a circle, this is what comes out. Pick up any point and move ahead. If there are less women in Industrial Revolution 4.0, there'll be less women-centric designs. Why I said women-centric is because at present, gender is toxic against women gender. Maybe 30 years down the line, it might become toxic against men. You never know. But at this point of time, there are less women-centric designs like the two examples I showed you. And hence, less women feel empowered by technology because technology is not addressing their needs and aspirations. And because of that, very few women are finally motivated to come towards technology stream, and this is a vicious cycle. Pick up any one point and you would find it moves on. So I close the challenges here and bring you and summarize the paradigm shift. pre-industrial revolution 4.0 and post-industrial 4.0. If you just, I would not like to go through it, but if you have a look at this, you would find pre-industrial revolution 4.0, we were trying to create intelligent processes that required data, but now it's just the other way around. Earlier, we were trying to be AI-specific people. I did my first algorithm as an intern in artificial intelligence way back in 88. Not even 88, sorry, 84, when I did my diploma in computer application. The first algorithm I wrote was artificial intelligence search techniques. But despite that, we only focused on AI. We never thought of amalgamating it with GIS or with other related technologies. So now we moved on to a converged scenario, which was never there earlier. Similarly, now we are talking of personalized and contextualized reality. That means give user experiences, UX and UI, user interface are the buzzwords now. Earlier it was just GUI, graphic user interface. So what I'm trying to say that there's a total paradigm shift and hence the skills would change. Skills need to be, all of us have said see, that, we
you,
don't.
You have 30 more seconds.
Yes, sir, I realized by looking at your face. So skilling 4.0 is what I'm trying to say. Sensitize, teach, train, and handhold institutes. Sensitization should be with community. Teaching should be innovative on three fronts, soft skills, technical skills, and business skills both. Training should also use all innovative pedagogy, including virtual reality. I've just picked up some cases to show you it works. And we need to change ourselves at global level, national level, and local level. Governments need to provide infrastructure, provide standards. I'm part of digital service standards of the country along with J.S. Satnarayanji, and I think we are working in the right direction. States also need to look into technologies, pick it up and contextualize to the reality of a country. And let's not ignore startups. All the startups are already here. Last but not the least, establishing a center of excellence for skilling 4.0, as I have called it, is very important so that there is one place where all the best practices lie, one place which can afford to develop proof of concepts and collaborate with all the partners. And also, while doing that, let's stay very women-centric in our approach towards designing, which is not just business-wise very lucrative, health-wise very good. We might save several women from disasters, and hence it translates to what is called a social good profit. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.